everybody, and thank you for watching my channel. Pretty excited about today's topic. We're going to be talking about the tactics of manipulation and understanding the control dramas. And I think that during this time, the way the world is going, I think it's very important to understand these. It was important before. It's, I think right now, the way the world is going and how I see things, the dynamics between people, lately, it's important to understand these principles of the control dramas. Before I get started, I want to read a quote from James Redfield, and it goes like this. Once we are spiritually connected, great relationships can then be developed around true interests and compatibility without involving a need for security. Disagreements are liberated to be resolved through compromise, clarity, and an intuitive knowing. I think that's super important when we talk about this. Right now, a lot of relationships are being destroyed or ruined just because people are having a difference of opinion or they see the world differently. And it's fascinating because there's all kinds of stuff out there talking about there is no truly right or wrong. There is only an experience. And you can say that to people and it'll really upset them because they have a very definitive right and wrong. It's all very black and white for them. And it's interesting because when we talk about the natural law, we have the law of duality or law of polarity that some people refer to it as. And we have to understand both sides in order to find some kind of middle ground, in order to find balance. And well, when we are so far into you're wrong and I'm right, then we find an imbalance. And it's like if you really kind of feel that energy of pointing your fingers at somebody and saying you're wrong, you'll really just kind of feel, almost backed into a corner. And so, and interesting enough, if you feel that, if you feel that energy that you're pointing at somebody, you're pointing all this very aggressive anger towards them. And it's something we really need to start paying attention and thinking about because when it comes to the control dramas and tactics of manipulation, what we're actually doing is we're trying to bring people into our way of seeing things, but we're using manipulation tactics in order to do that. It's important to understand that everyone has a natural tendency to rely on a form of control. And we do this when we go into a state where we feel that our world or life is not in control. So it can be something where we're backed into the corner or you know, your whole foundation is being shook up, your marriage is failing, your relationship is failing, your job is not doing so well, or people being mean to you or making you feel insecure about yourself. Right now with the current president that is in office, a lot of people feel very insecure about where their life is going to go because they've been used to it being a certain way up to this point. Other people are really upset because are not so upset because they're feel like they're getting their way, and maybe they are in a sense. I'm not really sure. I'm not really here to discuss what is right or wrong as far as the politics goes. What I'm here to discuss is the emotional reaction that's happening within inside of ourselves, and how you can see people with their natural tendencies trying to control their world and get that some semblance of feeling safe and secure within their lives. So the next bullet point here is exactly what I was already just talking about, is to say when our world feels like it is being threatened, we can default to our natural state. So right now people's world is being shook up, it's being threatened. There's a whole bunch of things going on in the world and we're getting set off by the smallest little thing. And I'm not saying that we don't speak truth, because that's it. When I talk about stillness and kindness to people, they really think that I'm saying, well, I'm not supposed to do anything about it. I'm not saying that at all. So what I'm saying is that if you can understand your emotional reaction, if you can understand who you are, if you can get calm in yourself, then when you speak truth, it comes with a tremendous amount of power. Because when you're reacting, you're fueling the fire and you're showing weakness in a sense. When you're calm, when you're stable and you're strong in yourself with love and compassion, then you are you're showing this tremendous amount of empowerment. When you come in like anger and you feel like, you know, to overpower somebody, then you're coming in and it's very obvious that you're coming in with weakness and with a sense of insecurity in yourself. And that's the subtle difference that people don't really understand. They think that when I'm coming in angry and upset and I'm going to get you and I'm going to tell you exactly how I feel and I'm going to put you in your place and all that, they think that that's strength. That they think that that's being assertive. That is not being assertive. But when you come in with love and compassion, but with truth and holding somebody accountable in love, then that's truly empowered. You are a very powerful being at that state. And so When we talk about the tactics of manipulation and the control dramas, we understand where we're coming from so that we can react differently, in a sense. We still have that initial natural reaction, but we can change that. And I'm going to talk about it in another slide, and we'll get deeper into that. But it's through self-awareness that we can change our internal reactions. And it's interesting because as we have these internal reactions, these reactions manifested within the reality. And we don't want to have these just knee-jerk reactions that are happening within ourselves, because that can cause hard feelings, that can change our entire world, can break up relationships. It can. I see people out there saying, if you believe in Donald Trump, or if you supported Donald Trump, just unfriend request me. And I saw during the election, if you are a supporter of Hillary Clinton, then just unfriend request me. And I'm like, that right there makes zero sense whatsoever. You're going to end your friendship or your connection with somebody because they see something as differently. And the other part is that, interesting enough, on both sides I saw this, where people were saying things, well, if you are a supporter of Hillary Clinton, then you have zero idea of what's going on. And you know what? I saw all the stuff with Pizzagate and all that kind of stuff, and all the things about the emails and all that stuff. And I've seen all the stuff about Donald Trump as well. But what I'm trying to get at is that people were saying that, they would make the statement, that wake the fuck up. And understand what's going on here. And you know what? Every time somebody says, wake the fuck up, I just think to myself, hey, there's a part of yourself that's not awake. And most of those people out there that say that they're awake, they're not. And you know what? Guess what? This guy right here has some things to learn himself. And there's areas where I'm not completely awake. And the one thing that I know for sure is that I know nothing. The one where I talk about subjects that I've been teaching for a long time, but I'm going to also tell you something. I learn about these things on a daily basis. When I talk about the tactics of manipulation and the control dramas, every day I'm processing this, and I'm thinking about it, and I'm pondering it, and relating it to my experience or my current experience that's happening in my life. That's a constant state of self-awareness. You're never going to be completely self-aware, not when you're sitting in this physical body. Well, what I'm saying is that practice what I call the self-awareness game. So what you're doing is you're constantly pondering, you're constantly thinking, you're constantly discerning about where you're going and what just happened and where what could have happened and that kind of stuff, so that you start to change and grow and build into something stronger. Because there's a core within you, there's an energy core that's within you, and when you're empowered, you can feel that energy core. You can feel it flowing through you and flowing into the universe. And when you can get in that state of truth and be in that presence and practice staying there for longer and longer periods of time, this is the self-awareness game, when you can practice. Because we're down here in this planet, in this flesh body, we're practicing. And so what's happening, and when we look at somebody and say, you need to wake the fuck up, then really what we're doing is we're pointing our finger and we're saying, hey, guess what? I need to wake the fuck up. Because we're not willing to look at where we're unawake or we're not doing something. And the only thing we can do as teachers and people that are trying to change consciousness is practice it within ourselves. And so even as I do this video, even as I do stuff from my YouTube channel, I have to continue to practice. And it doesn't mean I get it right all the time. You know, my friends have permission to hold me accountable. And guess what? As the viewers of this YouTube channel, you can put a comment and say, hey, you know what? Have you thought about this? Have you thought about that? And there's nothing wrong with that, because that's how we grow. When we're challenged, we grow. So now what ends up happening is that when we are challenged, sometimes it makes us feel insecure about ourselves. And it makes us feel insecure about ourselves. Guess what? We're jumping into our natural state of wanting to control our world. But let's jump into other parts of the levels of control. So there's three levels of control. When it comes to the personal control dramas, there is healthy driven. So a healthy driven person understands that what their natural state is, what they revert back to when they start to feel a lack of control. They're aware of it, they process through it, and they find a different reaction or a different response. A unconsciously dangerous person, this is a person that doesn't know where they're coming from. They're not intending to do what they're doing. They really think that what they're doing is correct and how they're responding is correct. They're unconscious about it. They don't see what's happening on a conscious level, but they're still dangerous. And so the other one is deliberately dangerous. These people, somebody that's in this state, they're aware of what they're doing. They consciously are aware of that they're manipulating somebody, that they're controlling somebody. There's no conscious of or remorse of why they're doing it. They don't feel any type of guilt or any type of response. They just know what they're doing, and they're doing it on purpose. And so they're extremely dangerous, because those are the people that are doing it, in my opinion, for self-gain. They're trying to do it to, get a stronger influence or a stronger power in their life. And so that's a very dangerous state to be in. That's a very dangerous person to be around, in a sense, because we don't want to fall victim to somebody that's trying to manipulate us. And, you know, guess what? Even for them, there's a part of themselves that they're not seeing the whole picture. Even though they're conscious of what they're doing, they're not seeing the whole picture of who they are and what they're connected to, in a sense. So they're, you can have a lot of compassion for them, in a sense, because they're not able to experience that wholeness of oneness, and they're not able to experience that love or compassion, that connection between people, because they're deliberately trying to control them. So those are the three levels of control. So let's jump into the four control dramas. There's two passive control dramas, the aloof and the poor me, and there is two aggressives. There is the intimidator and the interrogator. So when we look at these control dramas, it's important to understand that we have all four of these within us, but we tend to have more dominant ones in our lives. So, you know, I tend to be more of an aloof, in a sense, when it comes to my passive state. It means an aloof, and we'll talk about this in more detail, tends to want to avoid drama. They tend to want to just walk away from it. They're the type of person that if you're in a relationship and you're in a fight, they'll either leave the room or they'll ignore it, they'll walk by it, they won't pay attention because they just don't want to deal with it. And then there is the poor me, which we'll definitely go into more details as well here in a second. But the poor me is, it can be somewhat self-explanatory, because they're like, oh, woe's me, everything in the world is happening to me, why does this keep on happening? That kind of stuff. A good friend of mine, she recognizes that she's a poor me, and she'll fully admit it. And I recognize that I'm aloof, and I'll fully admit it. And the aggressive side, I tend to be more the intimidator. You know, so what happens is I try to avoid drama. I want to walk away from it. That's my natural state. But if I'm pushed into a corner, then I become the intimidator, the ones that's trying to call you names and beat you down and do whatever. I'm super aggressive, and it's because I want to be left alone. So think about the rabid dog, so to speak. And I'm, the rabid dog gets backed into a corner, and they're going to do whatever it takes to protect themselves. And so, you know, it's important for us to understand this, that I'm freely sharing with you my states. But it's important for you to look at yourself as well. It's not important for you to look at these and say, oh, my husband's like that, or my wife is like that. You know, we're going to do naturally some of that, but you want to turn it back in and look at yourself and say, I do that, or I do some of that. And, you know, you want to process it and go for it. You might even say, not some of that, but, you know, you might have to totally agree with everything, but it's really just thinking about the energy of it and the emotions behind it. The fourth one is the interrogator. The interrogator will ask you a bunch of questions. They'll be like, well, why did you do it that way? You could have done it this way. I don't see why you did it this way. And it's super aggressive on how they do it. It's not even in a kind way, or in a way where they're trying to understand. It's in a way, it's very obvious in the amount of aggressiveness and the aggression that comes with it, that they're trying to diminish who you are, or put down how you did it. And basically talk shit, so to speak, on how you did it. And so all these are come from a place of they're trying to control their world. So we'll talk more about it, but it's interesting because we got the aloof, poor me, intimidator, interrogator. So let's jump into some of these descriptions of these control dramas. So the poor me is a passive aggressive in the most secretly manipulative of the four styles. This person will portray a false sense of being a victim in order to appeal to another person's compassion, guilt, or obligation through the manipulation of their sympathies. So they basically try to rope you in, and it's a way to kind of get your energy a little bit, because you're involved, you're giving energy to it, and you're involved with that person trying to help them feel better about themselves, so to speak, and help them fix the situation. And so they latch on to you, or they have you latch on to them so they can feel better about themselves. This person causes disharmony by creating feelings of guilt and obligation, or need to appease or conform the person to their desires and beliefs. So it's interesting, because when you really think about this, somebody that is a poor me, they tend to be somewhat, they're trying to reel you in so they can get attention, so to speak. And it's funny, some of these reactions, I'm going to say this, we all have a little bit of narcissism within us, and we all have a little bit of codependency within us. So a narcissist is somebody that really needs a lot of attention, so to speak, and can be very self-absorbed. Well, when we have a codependent that wants to kind of take care of them and make them feel better about themselves and go in and hug them and take care of things and make their life easier and stuff like that, the narcissist needs this because they need it for attention. The codependent needs to feel like they're needed in a sense. So and it's funny. You see these dynamics in relationships where the prevalent one in codependency is the alcoholic or the drug user with the person that's trying to help them and save them, so to speak. And then they call that a savior mentality. And I would venture to say that most of us have a little bit of savior mentality within us. And we have we're at different levels, so to speak. And some of us are a little bit more narcissistic, and some of us are a little bit more codependent. But interestingly enough, the word codependent kind of involves both of them, because there is a dependency that happens between the codependent and the narcissist. But when we're looking at the control dramas and we're talking about the poor me, what would happen in this situation is that the person would try to constantly make them feel better or try to make their life easier. And if they didn't meet the expectations of the poor me would start to express that and then tell other people, oh, they're not doing what I need them to do, and don't they love me, don't they care about me, they told me this and they made me feel bad, how dare they talk to me, I don't need to be talked to like that, they don't need to be that aggressive with me, that kind of stuff. And so it's a interesting way of looking at things, because when you think about how they're doing it, and I want you to ponder that, if you've ever been a poor me before, and you look at the reasons why you did it, you'll understand what this particular control drama is all about. The other one is the aloof, and like I mentioned earlier, I tend to fall into this one myself, and it's interesting because I know that there's times where I'll try to avoid things, and I know I can also be that intimidator. I'll try to find a place in between, so I'll try to go off. I'll go off like I naturally would, think about it, ponder it before I go in, so I'm calm and collective, and then I'll go in and I'll try to talk to them if I feel the need to do so at that time. A lot of times I just calm myself down and realize, hey, I changed the story within inside of myself, and the story is what we can really change and be proactive about how we see things and start to change these control dramas and stop the initial reaction that happens within our body. But let's talk about the aloof. The aloof is just a less passive and manipulative than the poor me, but more secretive. The aloof approach is to create a vagueness and facade around themselves, forcing an undeserved investment of energy to gain information, commitment, and emotion, which should normally be shared in a straight up and direct way. Now, I don't tend to necessarily do that, but actually I did, because when I was younger, I would try to not talk about things that make, you know, of who I was as a person. And why? Because I wanted people to like me. I wanted people to care about me and stuff like that, instead of just being very real with who I was. And so when you're real with who you are, people fully understand who you are, and then they love the person that you are. And so what happens is we try to build this vision or this facade of who we are, especially if we're practicing in this natural state of aloofness. And so when we do that, then when the walls collapse, people get really upset and they're destroyed in a sense, because it hurts them. So the other part is that the aloof is essentially their high maintenance, causing the other person to work hard at breaking through their facade in order to identify their true needs and desires. So they come off sometimes very controlled, and I will admit that I do this at times myself still, because you know, you don't want to open up your heart, so to speak. You don't want to talk, you know, and open up fully to people, because you know, you're trying to protect yourself. So and sometimes you put this cold facade, and I do this myself too. I break out of it, and I have to force myself out of it. That's why I want you guys to really think about it, and processing and telling you what I do, so you can see that I'm practicing this myself as well. So by their indirectness, their tact, and their facade, they appeal to us, but we try to develop an intimate or collaborative relationship. And when we do that, they retract, become distant and unapproachable. They do this because they are afraid that their inner secrets, fears, and inadequacies their inadequacies may be exposed. Whew, Jeremy can't talk today. And I'm not re-recording this either because whatever. We're right here and you know what? We're enjoying ourselves. So, funny enough, when we're talking about the aloof, when we're speaking with them, it's important to love them and be caring to them. It's also very important to be very direct with them. And so when you're dealing with this type of person, a funny story, and I actually have a friend that practices this with me, when I kind of want to run out of the room and or just kind of avoid something with her, she'll say, "What emotional response are you wanting me to have right now? Because obviously you're wanting me to have something." And I'll turn around and like, "I don't know what you're talking about." And she'll say, "Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do. And I love you enough and care about you enough to tell you." So if you can even do this with your spouses or your friends and practice this and hold each other accountable. I just had a friend do it with me today and say, "Jared, that's not the things that you teach other people." And so it's important to create a safe environment for your friends, family, and loved ones to be able to speak that in that way with you, to be frank with you. And if you can create a safe space, then your friends, family, and loved ones can be your teachers or others. They can help you get strong in this because they're the ones that love you enough to say, "Hey, I want to do this for you." But it has to be a two-way street, by the way, because you have to be able to feel free to talk to them about stuff as well. So it's important to really think about this because the aloof is a very strong energy that they really try to control, but it's very subtle how they do it. So let's jump into the interrogator, the one of the aggressive ones. So the interrogator is more aggressive but less manipulative. See, there I can say it, than the other two passive secretive types. The interrogator uses style of drama by evaluating and asking questions with specific purpose of finding something wrong or corrupt. So what an interrogator will do, they'll even enter in a relationship and they'll start asking questions or they'll make comments that to draw you into a discussion or a even into an argument, so to speak. If they find something that can evoke a sense of conscious in a person that confuses and criticizes their intent, position, or commitment, if this strategy succeeds, then the individual being criticized is pulled into a drama which will never resolve in their favor. So in other words, they get trapped. The trap lies in the individual feeling consistently judged by the interrogator and paying attention to what the interrogator may be thinking and feeling about them. So it's funny because when you you're dealing with this person, they ask a lot of questions and then but it's super, like I said earlier, it's super aggressive in how they do it. As they ask these questions, it's like, then they'll start to go, "Well, why did you do it that way? And, you know, I could have done this, this is the way you should have done it." And then it's almost like they're trying to prove you're wrong. They're trying to prove that you've done something wrong because they're trying to tear down the walls and make you into something in their mind bad so that they can walk away or run away. And it's because, especially when it comes to romantic relationships, that the people that do this, they're trying to, in a sense, make an excuse to leave, so to speak. But with the interrogator also, what they do is that they're trying to, if the person they're trying to do it with, they're trying to almost beat you down so that they can feel better about themselves and feel strong in themselves, but because there's a weakness within them. They don't feel very strong in themselves at all. And so when we go into this mode, that's we're in the sense of not a lot of inner strength in a sense, because inner strength comes from this love that I was talking about earlier. Love is power, strength. And it's not this love and light stuff that a lot of people are out there talking about. They're like, "Love and light, love and light." That's not what we're talking about. Love is this power and this energy that gets us strong within ourselves. And even as I say it, I get strong within myself. And so I want you to fully understand what love is all about, because it's not about love and light, love and light, love and light. Love says and holds people accountable sometimes. Love comes out and speaks the truth to people. Love comes out and sometimes walks away and says, "Hey, not my circus, not my monkey, not getting involved in that. That's their lesson. That's their journey." And love, but love also sometimes turns around and says, "What are you doing? What is that all about?" And love sometimes is looking at yourself in the mirror and saying, "Hey, That doesn't work for me. And we gotta stop having that happen. We gotta stop being where we're at right now. So love sometimes means holding yourself accountable. So, you know, moving on to the intimidator, intimidators are the most aggressive of the four types. Their presence is well stated and felt, and there is a threatening air of danger conveyed from them. They are unpredictable and can threaten, use harsh words and abusive actions uncontrollably. They will demonstrate a capacity for rage or violence. These are people that can hit or just use a lot of verbal lashings. And when I get into this state, I'm not a physically violent person, but I will say a lot of things that are hurtful, and it's because I'm trying to do whatever it takes to win, so to speak. And in these situations, there is no win-win, by the way. There is only a lose-lose. And so if you've walked away from an argument or something where you're like, oh, I won that argument. Oh, I proved them. Oh, I showed them. Then honestly, what you've done is you lost. And that's the truth. You both lost because there's no love. There's no compassion. There's no compromise. There's no anything in that particular discussion. There was just you won. You felt better about yourself, and honestly, what you made yourself feel like, or what you made yourself look like, is an asshole. And so I know, because I've been there. I've been that asshole that walked away and said, "Ugh, I showed that person." And really, what I did is diminished some trust between myself and that person. And that's what we really need to start thinking about: is do we want to build solid foundations in love and compassion, or do we want to build foundations in hate and anger and weakness, so to speak? As far as you know, not being in that love state. So I've been talking a lot about the story and how we can change this and how we can practice through self-awareness and how we can, you know, once we are aware of our natural state as far as the control dramas, how we can change that initial reaction. And how we can do that is through a path to an emotional response. And this is actually by a group of people called Vital Smarts. They did a lot of studies on, they're social scientists, and they did a lot of studies on people's internal reactions and how they respond to things. And so, and if you see here, it's hard for me to show you here. I do this lecture in my classes at work. But if you can see this, you can see the first part of it says, you see and hear something. So you see or hear something, you read it on Facebook, or you hear something at work, or you hear something at church, or whatever. Whatever it is you're doing, you have an interaction. There's a dynamic happening. You see it. Then what starts to happen is you start to tell yourself a story. There's something going on. So you might be thinking, wow, what a jerk. You might be thinking, wow, this person has no idea what they're talking about. Wow, this person doesn't know me at all. What the hell are they thinking about? And, you know, that's that initial response that's starting to swell up, that story that's starting to build within you. They don't really get me at all. They don't really understand a thing about me. How dare they talk to me? This is the story happening. And those stories start to work into feelings. And so that's the next part of that arrow that you see on the screen. So then the feelings start building up, and the anger starts coming, and the sadness, and the depression, and all that other kind of stuff, and then you act. And so where you could have changed this is in the tell a story. Because you can change that story right then. You can change it from whatever it is. You can go out of the aloof state. You can go out of the interrogator state. You can go out of the intimidator state. You can go out of the poor me state. Wherever it is, whatever area you're at and that you're getting ready to try to control through your control dramas, through your story, wherever you're going with this, you can stop it right there. You can say, you know what? I don't have all the facts. I don't fully understand this. That actually just happened recently. I had a phone call from somebody, and they said something about another person, and I felt obligated to take care of it. And then as I started to go through the reaction, and even was around some people, and I started to talk to them about it, I started reacting, and I stopped and said, well, wait a second, maybe what I need to do is call this person that this, you know, this reaction is coming from. So I called them. And when I called them, it was not the story that was being told to me at all. And when I realized that the one person, this person A, that called me initially to say something and got started to form the reaction about person B, that I realized that person A was running through the story and was wanting to project that story onto me so I would have the same reaction. I call this tribal mentality, so we can get together and talk about this person and feel better about ourselves. And then We can be mad at person B. So when I talked to person B and spoke to them, the story wasn't at all what they were talking, what I was hearing. So when I made the phone call was the choice to change the story. You know, because I said to myself, let me see what's really going on. Let's hear both sides of the story. Now, it could have initially I found out that originally what was said to me by person A was true. Then it would have been a different response. You know, I still might not have reacted. You know, I tend to take the approach that I'm going to stop, think about it, then I'll respond. And so I find that time to think about things really helps me, you know, with this self-awareness game. So as it really gets me into this state of, where am I at? How am I thinking about things? Where do I want to be? How would I want to say it? And is it worth saying at all? That's taking empowerment, because then you're making a choice on how you're going to respond. You're making an emotional choice on how you're going to respond. And that's true empowerment, to make an emotional choice, a choice. The key word is choice on how you're going to respond. So this is a path to an emotional reaction, and you can change that right at the story. And I want you to really think about that. Think about all the times you've reacted, and you can flip that story. You can change it. You can speak differently. You can react differently, so to speak. And what is that all about? That is being proactive. This is from Stephen Covey's 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. But basically, if you see here, the proactive response is that area where there's a stimulus happening. That's that initial see here thing that I was telling you about in the previous slide. And then there's the response. So in the between there, when you choose that story, you're really choosing freedom. Because what are you practicing then? You're practicing with self-awareness, independent will, consciousness, and you're letting your imagination not get wandered out into whatever. You're saying your imagination is now going into, you know what, whatever happened, happened. I love this person no matter what, and I'll deal with it with truth and compassion and understanding and kindness. And so, you know, what is different? The difference is if we took that stimulus and response, those yellow squares that you see on the screen, you put them together, and there was no space in between, that would be a reactive state. That would mean you went from the see here, and the story happened, the emotions happened, and then you acted, and there was no thought or any type of conscious feeling or pondering or thinking about it at all. You just went from 0 to 60 without even thinking about it, and then you responded, and you showed them, you told them, and you put them in their place, so to speak. And then even if you didn't say anything, because remember the different control dramas would respond differently, even if you didn't say anything, you had an emotional reaction internally without processing it proactively. And that's super important. Super, super important. So going on, I want to talk about the emotional bank account. This is also from 7 Habits of Highly Effective People from the Covey stuff. And I want you to show there's the green side where it says emotional bank account. There's the pink one. And then there's the purple one. So if we look at the emotional one that says deposits, so the green slip, it says courtesy, respect, kindness, calmness, openness, commitment, empathy. This puts deposits into your bank account. And then if you look at what the pink slip, it says emotional accounts, withdrawals. This is the resentment. This is the contempt, backbiting, office gossip, withdrawing, disrespect, overreacting, and blaming. So we want to be careful with it. We don't overreact. This is why it's super important for you to stop, pause, think about what you're going to say before you say it. Think about it before you react. That's being proactive. And if you can be proactive, I can tell you, you'll alleviate from this backbiting, disrespect, overreacting, blaming, contempt, and resentment. And you'll get more into the courtesy, respect, kindness, calmness, openness, commitment, and empathy. So what ends up happening is that these minuses, if they get too far down, you can go from that high score with an individual into a low score. And guess what? And that's what the third one says, emotional bank account trust balance is. Do you have a high level of trust for this person, a neutral level of trust, or a low level of trust? I can tell you if you have more minuses than you do deposits or withdrawals than deposits, there's not going to be a lot of trust between you and that individual or that group of people, because you've depleted it. So as Donald Trump keeps up making these things out there, these whatever he's saying to hurt people's feelings or get them riled up, as the news keeps on reporting things just to get them to react, there's going to be a trust that's going to be diminished between themselves, excuse me, themselves and the president and the government, and that's already out there because people think about the government, and people most of the time in the United States can say, you know what, I don't trust any of them. Even if they voted for somebody, they don't trust them. And so what kind of world is that where we vote for somebody and we're forced to vote for somebody we don't trust? And so what kind of world is it that we've built that level of distrust with our world, that the lack of love in our world, and where did we get, how did we get to this point? And so we got to that point because we kept on making withdrawals. You know, there kept on being withdrawals happening to where now our emotional bank account is depleted and we don't trust our government at all. That can happen in relationships, it can happen with our bosses, it can happen with our jobs, it can help if you're a boss with your employees, that kind of stuff. And when the emotional bank account is depleted, that's when things, when divorce starts happening, when people start getting terminated from jobs, where you know, you get written up at work, all this other kind of stuff. That's where the emotional bank account for the individual that's responding in a negative way, they've gotten to that point. And it's a two-way street, by the way. You could have both been contributing to that, and you know, just one responded faster than the other one, so to speak. But the trust is gone so far on one level that they had to go to that extreme measure. So the circle of influence, this is what I was talking about earlier. If you practice with that calmness, compassion, love, understanding, then your circle of influence, you'll see there's the proactive focus and then the reactive focus. And if you're in the proactive focus, then you're responding with love, compassion, calmness, peace, all that kind of stuff. And you're practicing self-awareness. You're practicing changing your story before you hit that action. And by the way, you can still, by the way, process your story and say to yourself, no, definitely need to speak the truth here. I need to go stand on a street corner with a sign saying, I don't agree with this. At least you did something to say, I've thought about it, and I'm making a conscious choice to do this. Because when you make a conscious choice, you are empowered. When you make an unconscious choice, a reactive choice, you are disempowered because you didn't actually make a choice. You were literally cattle making or sheep making a reaction without thinking about it. Now, the reactive focus, and you can see the circle of influence is a lot smaller here. The proactive focus is rather large. And so being proactive doesn't mean you don't speak the truth. And sometimes speak a harsh truth to make people see things. You know, if you see something and you're speaking truth, at least strongly within yourself that you believe is true, people can respect that. I know that if somebody says something to me and they believe it with all their heart and it's with truth, I might not agree with it, but in the end, I'll respect them. Why? Because they had enough courage to say something to me. They had enough courage to speak up and say, hey, what I see you're doing is harmful for not only you, but other people. And that's a cool thing. That's a cool for them to speak up with that level of trust. So the last slide on here, actually, I'm sorry, this is not the last slide. I titled it Peace Be Still. That's the title of my book. But I don't think that's necessarily important. What I do think is important is that Peace Be Still comes from that empowered state when you are at that peaceful state, that loving state where you feel super energized in yourself and you know you're in balance with your life. And I thought that was important with the slide because it says if the control dramas are a part of the struggle for power. So remember, the person that's in there that state of trying to control, they're trying to be powerful in this space instead of empowered. So there's a struggle going on for power. So the quote goes, if the control dramas are a part of the struggle for power, I want to learn to stop struggling. I want to know how we can interact with others in a way that is less of a struggle, less drama, and less conflict. And why I think this is super important is the two elephants with their noses tied together, or they're pulling away from each other. But there's also kind of an upside down heart position there in this particular picture. But important, my friend that I was telling you about earlier, she and I have been friends for years now, and there was a 4-year period where we weren't friends. And she used to say all the time that we were two asses tied together trying to pull. You know, two mules, stubborn mules trying to pull. And so there was a lot of drama that happened in between us, but we had to go off, learn, and we were the catalyst for each other, in a sense, to grow, because we pushed each other away so that we could go on and grow, and then we came back to each other. But, you know, if this is super important when you look at it, because the key word here is struggle for power. And when you're in that struggle for power, when you let go and let things happen the way they need to, when you go into flow, when you speak the truth, when you, flow is love, love is flow. And when you're in that state, then everything just tends to flow to you, and you have a more empowered way of living. So this is the last slide, and it says on here, it says, I love you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, and thank you. It's the Ho'oponopono prayer. And I put this meme on here. It says, keep calm and do the Ho'oponopono. And what that means is that that's a Hawaiian for I love you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, thank you. And so when you are upset with somebody, when you're angry with somebody, say this, I love you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, thank you. Not directly to them. It's an energy thing. Say it in your prayer, I love you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, thank you. I love you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, thank you. Think about that person that you're upset about and say that over and over and over again until the energy of anger and angst and stress of the situation ends. And so what will end up happening is that you'll say this and all these emotions are going to come up. And as you say it, you'll look at these emotions, you'll say, I love you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, thank you. Because what you're doing is you're letting go of control. And when you're letting go of control, the anger starts to subside, the stress starts to subside, and then you go into that state of love, that state of flow. And that's super powerful. I hope you enjoyed this video. I'm going to be doing other subjects. This is just one that I've taught for a long, long time. And, you know, I might even do some addendums onto this. There is a blog out there that I talked a lot more about this. I'm going to put it in the comments below. And basically, the blog is you cannot rationalize or make sense of crazy. Don't go to codependent hell with somebody. So I'll post the link to that to my blog in the comments below. Thank you, and you have a blessed day.